In the late 1960s, one of the more popular attractions at Disneyland was Great Moments with Mr. Lincoln, which displayed one of the first audio animatronic devices, which featured President Abraham Lincoln giving a rousing speech. It was impressively lifelike at the time, even though the machinery was still in a rudimentary stage. I will never forget an incident that happened just after the show was completed. An older lady in her 80s had mistakenly believed that the audio animatronic was a real human being. Indeed, she thought it was performed by a very talented actor. She was so impressed by the performance that she went up to the usher to see if she could get the performer's autograph. You can imagine her shock when she was informed that it was not a human being, but a machine. Interestingly, the same thing happened to me when I went on the Pirates of the Caribbean when it first opened up at Disneyland. As we were navigating through the underground tunnels with an assortment of decorated pirates regaling their exploits, I looked on one pirate overhanging from the bridge who appeared to look me right in the eye. I turned towards my friend and said, "That pirate is a real person." Indeed, I was so convinced that the apparent audio animatronic was an actor dressed in costume that I refused to believe otherwise until several years later when I realized it was the lighting that had played a trick on my eyes. Although it was initially billed as a scary ride, the Haunted Mansion turned out to be quite tame. However, there was one segment on the ride where a friend of mine got the creeps, since he assumed that the head, without a body, within the crystal ball was a real person. He hadn't realized how far holographic technology had come and couldn't imagine that it was merely a vaporous projection. I bring up these three examples because they underline something fundamental in our assessment of the consciousness of others. We can easily be duped. Not only can we impute conscious intentionality onto machine-operated mannequins that lack it, we can even do it to photographic film. Yet, phenomenologically speaking, our own experience at the time of interacting with audio robots seems essentially the same as when we talk to certain humanoids. In other words, that which we believe is conscious turns out to be, on closer inspection, unconscious, at least in the common sense ways that we use such terms in our day-to-day lives. But we don't need to go to Disneyland to discover this, since we already have first-hand experience of innumerable conflations when we fall asleep and dream. In a strong dream, so many characters come alive and we interact as if each of them is real. Only when we wake up do we acknowledge that everything that occurred in the dream was simulated by us. We are, in sum, dreaming ourselves in varying guises, even if we may be deceptively tricked to believe otherwise. Such is the confusing nature of our own self-awareness that we even objectify our own personas in various garbs and believe them to be ontologically apart from our own neural projections. Consciousness is a fantastic virtual simulator, and because of its inclusivity and insular engineering, it has an inherent tendency to believe its own machinations as exterior to itself and not as the byproduct of its own interiority. The problem of other minds has long been a philosophical conundrum among thinkers from centuries past. The difficulty gets even stickier when we pause and realize that we don't even have a full and complete access to our own minds and its labyrinth-like permutations, since there are so many processes within our skull and body which we remain dutifully unaware. Saying that all things are experienced through awareness unnecessarily reifies the very word awareness, since consciousness is not a thingy, but a process as fluid as the tons of water cascading down Niagara Falls.